Everyone. Oh, come on. It's a beautiful day. Good morning. There we go. There we go. Like that. Welcome to St. John's. We're glad you're here today. I'm Lynn Reese. I'm a member here. And we come every Sunday to this community we call St. John's so that we can reestablish those connections. And hopefully we think about and pray for each other during the week for everything that everybody in this congregation, they have different things going on in their lives right now. And I hope you'll keep that in mind as we go through the week. Bow with me in prayer today as we open worship. Lord, we thank you for this time where we can come together and praise you as one. Whether it be in this community we call St. John's, or in our community we call Albuquerque, or the global church. We know there is so much going on in the world, and we need your help. We need your help to shine your light to these, all these individuals in this community, to know that they are loved and that you are with them. For it's in your name we pray. Amen. And as part of keeping that community going, I want you all to stand up and greet each other and say hello. Do not be afraid to ask for a name. If you can't remember the name, ask. Say, help me with your name. Let's greet each other.
Stand and sing with us today.
You don't have a job, don't pay your bills, won't buy you a home in Beverly Hills. Won't fix your life in 5 easy steps. Ain't the law of the land or the government. shelter to weather the storm, and I'll be my brother's keeper, so the whole world will know that we're not alone.
Good morning.
You're not very good at that, are you? Good morning. Much better. I give you an A minus. I'm Kathy Bell, a retired school teacher, if you were just guessing. I am a member here at St. John's, and I'm going to be reading scripture today from 1 John chapter 3, verses 1 through 7. See what love the Father has given us, that we should be called children of God. And that is what we are. The reason the world does not know us is that it did not know him. Beloved, we are God's children now. What we will be has not yet been revealed. What we do know is this: when he is revealed, we will be like him, for we will see him as he is, and all who have this hope in him purify themselves, just as he is pure. Everyone who commits sin is guilty of lawlessness. Sin is lawlessness. You know that he was revealed to take away sins, and in him there is no sin. No one who abides in him sins. No one who sins has either seen him or known him. Little children, let no one deceive you. Everyone who does what is right is righteous, just as he is righteous. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Well, good morning again to everybody. It's so good to see you here. My name is Josh Corey. I'm the senior pastor here at St. John's, and it's always a pleasure coming and worshiping with you on Sunday mornings. As we get ready, we're going to collect an offering in a few moments, and all you have to do is, as we're singing our next song, you can bring those offerings to the bowls here on the left or the right. It's not compulsory. But what I want to invite you, why I want to invite you to do it, is because we're talking about connection today and the importance of connection. We'll talk about that a little bit more in the sermon, but connection is something that we come to church for. It's one of the very important things we come to church for, and when we give, it connects us to God and the work of the church. It connects us in deep and important ways to things, not just here at St. John's, but all around the world. One of those things that I want to talk to you especially about with connection is happening tonight, starting at 6, I think it starts at 6:30, let me make sure, yeah, 6:30. And that is the orientation class. If you're new here at St. John's, the orientation class is just a four-week get-together where we learn a little bit about Christian history, Methodist history, St. John's, and what makes it unique, and ways to connect. That's week number four. That is such an important thing, because when we're starting out at a church, it's scary, right? Let me tell you, the first time I came to church youth group, which was my first meaningful connection to church, it happened after a fight with my parents. Wasn't happy about going. Was kind of growing into that era in being a teenager where you're cynical and dark and other obnoxious things like that. And when I came to youth group, we walked in the door, my brother and I, and this girl came and said hello to us. And she was way too pretty to be talking to me. And then the next week we came back, and she remembered our names. And that's the best evidence for God's existence that I needed at that time. So, but it was a connection, right? It was, and lots of connections happened in that group. Connections that still shape and form me today. So connect yourself to God through this time, through your giving, but also through your worship. And come check out, if you don't feel connected yet to St. John's, come check out the orientation class this evening, because it will be a way to make some friends and also get connected in. With that, let us pray. Gracious God, we thank you for this day and for the ways that you connect to us, that you're always reaching out to us, and your grace is there for us every moment of our lives. We thank you for that. We thank you for Jesus, who came to show us that. In his name we pray. Amen.
Down and troubled and
think of me, and soon I will be there to brighten up even your darkest night. You just
This is the Abide service. It's funny, that word comes up in both readings today. In the everyday world, it means, oh, to accept or tolerate. Can you abide something? In the Bible, it means more to live, stay, dwell, remain. I wonder, perhaps a teenager might abide in his music. We abide in the Lord. And he abides in us. God chose to invite us to this relationship, and God gave us the choice of how to respond. Let us pray. Holy Lord, thank you for inviting us to abide in you. Down through time, you've always chosen to invite us to you. You created us, not as servants, but as people with free will. Through Jesus Christ, you made a way for us to connect with you. You have always reached out to us in ancient times, through Moses and the prophets, more recently through the apostles, the authors of the gospels and epistles, and through countless others to this day, Lord. Even though people around us in this, even through people around us in this very room, you're inviting us to righteousness, to purity, to discipleship, and to your love. You chose us. Thank you, Lord, from the bottoms of our hearts. Please grant us perception, strength, perseverance, and love for the journey ahead to do your work and be your people. May this be a journey with our hearts as well as our minds. In this journey, Lord, many have troubles, but we are a connected people, connected to you as the vine. Jesus commanded us to love one another as he loved us. Some people we know are struggling with finances, loss of family or friends, health problems, relationship issues, habits and addictions, loneliness, or something else. Lord, please grant us the discernment to know how to be your hands and feet and guide us to help each other in love today and forward. Maybe that's us struggling, Lord. Please send us the wisdom to recognize our struggle, the help we need, the discernment to recognize that help, the grace to accept it, and the perseverance to endure, and perhaps to get past the struggle. Let us please take a moment in silence to remember those around us who are struggling. In this journey, Lord, we occasionally mess up. Please help us back to your love and forgive us for our mistakes, that we may again abide in you. Let us take a moment in sacrifice to confess our own sins and ask for forgiveness. And now let us pray together as Jesus taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Our second reading for today comes from the Gospel of John, chapter 15. These are Jesus' words. I am the true vine, and my Father is the vine grower. He removes every branch in me that bears no fruit. Every branch that bears fruit, he prunes to make it bear more fruit. You have already been cleansed by the word that I have spoken to you. Abide in me as I abide in you. Just as the branch cannot bear fruit by itself unless it abides in the vine, neither can you unless you abide in me. I am the vine, you are the branches. Those who abide in me and I in them bear much fruit, because apart from me, you can do nothing. Whoever does not abide in me is thrown away like fire and burned. I skipped a line. Whoever does not abide in me is thrown away like a branch and withers. Such branches are gathered, thrown into the fire and burned. If you abide in me and my words abide in you, ask for whatever you wish and it will be done for you. My Father is glorified by this, that you bear much fruit and become my disciples. As the Father has loved me, so I have loved you. Abide in my love. If you keep my commandments, you will abide in my love, just as I have kept my Father's commandments and abide in his love. I have said these things to you so that my joy may be in you and that your joy may be complete. This is my commandment, that you love one another as I have loved you. No one is greater love than this, to lay one down one's life for his friends. You are my friends if you do what I command you. I do not call you servants any longer, because the servant does not know what the master is doing. But I have called you friends because I have made known to you everything that I have heard from my Father. You did not choose me, but I chose you. And I appointed you to go and bear fruit that will last, so that the Father will give me whatever you ask in my name. I am giving you these commands so that you may love one another. This is the word of God for us, the people of God. Thanks be to God. Last week I did a little project in the backyard. It's something that I've been thinking about doing for about 3 years now. This is the kind of graduate level procrastination that I'm renowned for. But Wednesday, after 36 months of thinking about it, I went to Jericho Nursery and I bought a grapevine. I've wanted to grow one for a long time. They grow well here. And I planted my grapevine after work. And it was this dry brown stick. I bought a grapevine that had one little leaf. It was the only one in the whole nursery that had one little leaf sticking out of the dry brown stick, so I had proof of life. And even today, this morning, and as I was letting the dogs out before I left to come here, I noticed there were two little nubs of two new little branches that were already starting to come out, because grapevines grow very quickly, especially when it gets warmer. So when Jesus said, I am the true vine, and my Father is the vine dresser, and when Jesus said, I am the vine and you are the branches, he was talking to people who were personally acquainted with vines and the production of wine. Most of us, when we think of grapevines, it's sort of the way I'm talking about, sort of that backyard hobby, or maybe you have gone on vacation to Napa and seen vineyards, or maybe even gone to a vineyard here. There's some good ones here in New Mexico. But in Judea, in Jesus' day, wine production was commonplace. It was nearly universal. Archaeologists, whether they're excavating small villages or big cities from the ancient era, one of the most common artifacts that they find are wine presses. Even in the crummy little villages, even in places that are rich or poor or everything in between, everybody seemed to have a hand in making wine. And so Jesus was talking to people who knew what it was like to prune vines and press grapes and probably shooed birds away and waited for fermentation to take place. And he wanted them to reflect on what he was saying when he says, I am the vine. He's speaking in metaphor. He wants them to think about that when they are thinking about life in God's kingdom. He says it's just like growing up a vine with lots of branches. One of them reflect on that. It's even an integral part of our own faith. You know, part of one of our two sacraments in the United Methodist tradition is Holy Communion, and we even have our own spin on this. You know this already, at least some of you, this story. You know, Welch's grape juice was invented by Dr. Welch, who was a Methodist preacher and dentist. I had never thought about that combination of professions, but it is a good way to get a captive audience, I guess. And he saw in his ministry work, not in his dentistry work, that his congregants, many of them who are alcoholics, they had this dilemma when they would come forward to receive communion. So he devised Welch's grape juice to create an alcohol-free wine for them to receive. It wasn't done for commercial purposes, although I think it has worked out just fine. It was to be used in church. You even still in the Methodist tradition, because we have a long history of Methodists pushed prohibition and were anti-alcohol for a very long time. So you still hear every once in a while someone will come to a Methodist pastor and in hushed tones they will ask, can Methodists drink? And one of my friends, he's a pastor in the Texas Panhandle, sort of in the Bible Belt. He has this answer that I love, and he'll just look at people and he'll say, yes, it's sort of like the question, can Methodists dance? Some do, but some shouldn't. And I can tell you from personal experience that has borne out. I've been to many a Methodist wedding, doing the wedding, and then gone to the reception afterwards and seen that some of you can dance and some of you shouldn't. And same goes for drinking wine. So Jesus' analogy, though, of the vine and the branches works okay for both groups. A few years ago, I stumbled across this book by a woman named Gisela Kreglinger. She grew up in Germany, in Franconia, Germany. And her family owned a vineyard there. And they would grow white grapes for wine production. They had done this for generations. And so she grew up dressing vines and learning how to prune them and how to press grapes and all the different things that were involved. But then she went and got a PhD in theology, and she wrote this book that I just sort of stumbled across that was on the spirituality of wine. And it's this reflection on that work and how it informs our faith. And she points out all kinds of things about grapes and grapevines that connect us to, or that are connected to our faith. And so it turns out, a lot of these things, it turns out one thing in particular, that the way a grape becomes a grape, that process actually starts out in the roots of the grapes. There's sap in those roots that grow up and are pushed out of the roots and into the vine, and from the vine into the branches, and from the branches out into the individual clusters of grapes. But that sap is produced in the roots. There's a dependence on what is unseen. And so to me, what that says is when Jesus says, I am the vine, he is saying you only exist because you depend on me. Whether you've seen me or not, you only exist because you depend on me. This is a very un-American way of thinking about things, because in America, we like to think of ourselves as independent. But what God wants to tell us is that God created us to depend on God and to depend on Jesus. Gisela Kreglinger, she writes, when a vine lacks water and is under stress, it responds by growing roots. Its roots start to grow deeper and deeper in search of water. And then she adds this, and I thought this was really interesting. She said, deeper roots, the deeper the roots are, they interact with deeper and more layers of soil as they grow. And therefore, the wine that's produced by those grapes, by that vine, they become more complex and therefore more valuable. So the deeper the root, the better the wine. And I love that because, you know, we all hate stress. I mean, some of us actually have kind of an unhealthy love for stress, and we feel like we thrive in it. I'm not sure. I think that might be a rationalization. But none of us really love stress. But what she is saying is that with vines, there's stress because there's been no rain or even drought. What they do is they put down even deeper roots, and what they get from that is something much richer. Isn't that interesting? Because, see, God asks us to put down deep roots too, into God's soil. And the truth is, I know a lot of shallow-rooted people. I mean, most people, that's how, and I'm guilty of this sometimes too. I'm not putting anyone down. But a lot of times, this is how we live our lives in the sort of pop culture version of religion. And there's an allure to that, to have this thin, shallow social media sort of, the stuff you see in social media memes approach to theology. Just dabble in it a little and have shallow roots, but God wants us to have deep roots for the complexity that inevitably comes up in life. I understand the allure of it because, of course, there's that fear that if we had deep roots, we'd have to change the way we did things. Life would suddenly be more complex. And God calls us to exactly that, even if it makes us uncomfortable. God calls us to something deeper and more radical. Even Jesus here, he's telling the disciples this in his farewell discourse, in the speech that he gives them before he's going to be arrested and crucified, before and the government authorities and the religious elites that arrest him, the accusation that they make against him is that he's a radical. That's exactly what Jesus wants us to be. In fact, the word radical itself comes from Latin, the Latin word radix, which means root. We're to be a deep-rooted people. The depth of our roots might eventually even call us to change, might create a more complex and a richer approach to spirituality from what we find when we have shallow roots. That's a good thing. There are things we would have to let go of that we're attached to in favor of deeper roots. That leads to the next thing that Kreglinger talks about in her book. She talks about growing vines, and she talks about restraint, because grapevines have to be pruned. You can't just let them grow all over the place. You can ruin the land that way and overtax the land. You have to show restraint and figure out which vines are healthy and which branches are healthy. And if you don't do that, then you're going to have sick, undernourished vines and probably overtaxed soil. The Christian life requires some restraint. The Christian life requires some restraint, some differentiation, and wisdom. When we were growing up, my brother and I, we lived in this little house with our parents, and they had a grapevine in the backyard. And we would wait every spring as these little tendrils would form on the branches, that then pretty soon little berries would emerge from the tendrils. And pretty soon there'd be these little clusters of grapes growing. We did not have restraint, and so as soon as we could see those berries, we would pick them and eat them, and they were sour, and they weren't very good to eat. As far as we knew, grapes were something you got at the grocery store. We had this bush in our backyard that you could eat these sour, bitter, nasty grapes. I don't know why we did it. We weren't smart kids. But you need restraint. When you're growing grapes, if you leave vines to themselves, they eventually become, most vining plants, they sort of act like weeds. They will take over unless you prune them. They need pruning. They need restraint. Now, I want to be careful when I talk about pruning when it comes to our faith, because I've heard this talked about in genuinely horrible ways in sermons. Some people give bad sermons sometimes, not me, but other people give bad sermons sometimes. And so this pastor I was listening to, he would say that, yes, God prunes us, and when he does this so that we'll be healthier. And he said, God prunes us by giving us challenges, like illnesses. He mentioned cancer. I mean, does God give us cancer to prune us? I just don't think so. Does God make you get laid off from your job? He mentioned that too. Or break a relationship to prune you or break you or perfect you? That's a load of, that's a load of. But it's sort of been my experience that anyone who wants to preach that kind of thing, that God invented or caused disease to do good in someone's life, they're the ones that need to find the Lord. Most of all, because that's sick and evil logic. God doesn't inflict suffering. God is a source of strength during suffering. And I think maybe that's where the pruning happens, is sometimes as our faith deepens, sometimes as we meet challenges in harder times, we might notice that there are old, easy beliefs that don't work when we're challenged, and those we have to let go of. But God doesn't do things to us to punish us or to cause us to grow. What God does is he shows us through the hard times where our strong beliefs are that we can hold on to and those that we can let go of. What I found and what I would say is it's not just the things that we learn or the beliefs that we develop over the course of our lives that shape us, but it's also those beliefs that we do have to let go of when the pruning times come. In fact, that's a big part of why we need God. God connects us to God's self. God shows us who God is through that connection. And there's also this. God connects us to one another. And we need that too. We need lots of little branches all growing together that connect us to the vine. Branches connected to other branches. I mean, have you ever seen grapevines or really any kind of viney plant? You can't tell where one branch starts and another one ends. They're all woven in together. They grow and support one another and weave and twist and curl in among one another. And that's life as God wanted it for us as people. If you want to see the logical extreme of this, there's a little place that I found sort of by accident. About 15 years ago, I was walking outside. I was on a trip it was a study trip to the UK, and I had a day off, so I took a tour of a palace. And it was one of those magical June days in London where it was thick and foggy and freezing cold in June, and then it started raining really hard. London's a beautiful place like that. And so as I was touring this palace, we all had to sort of duck into this greenhouse. And as we walked inside, this entire greenhouse, which was about the size of this room, was filled with one grapevine. Okay, now it turns out it was planted by the gardeners who worked for King George III in 1769. That grapevine is 6 or so years older than our nation. And it was planted to provide grapes for the royal household, and it just has kept growing and it was tended to. And by the time we saw it, it was 12, the vine itself, just the central stump, was 12 feet in diameter. It was about as big as a large tree. And the vines growing off of it, which were organized very carefully in a very British way, extended off in 60 feet in every direction from that grapevine. Today, when they harvest it, they get about 700 pounds of grapes every year off of that vine. This is what good care of your vines can do if you have 250 or so years to spare. On the best year ever was 2003. It was a very rainy season, and they pulled 833 pounds of grapes off of that vine that used to feed kings and queens. And today they sell those grapes to provide for a charity for veterans. I think Jesus would be proud when he talks about God's kingdom as a vine and branches, for God's kingdom to be that kind of grapevine. Because we need that level of connection to be a part of something that's really big. This is a central challenge we have in modern culture today, is in modern society we live very atomized, disconnected, solitary lives. I mean, we live with the echoes of connection. We have information technology. We have more information at our fingertips than we've ever had before, and that's a good thing. And yet, we live with a lot more anxiety and fear on levels that are unprecedented in our culture. We have long friends lists on social media, but we talk to people less. Our connections are weak. So we're a people of information, which is fine, but we live impoverished lives in terms of connection and community with sort of an illusion of connection. So we're lonely people. And Jean Vanier, he writes this: to be lonely is to feel unwanted and unloved and therefore unlovable. Loneliness is the taste of death. No wonder some people who are desperately lonely lose themselves in anger or anxiety or even violence to forget the inner pain. So we need that connection. We need God in that connection too, to deepen our roots and to connect us with what matters. And that's where church comes in. Because church, when we're at our best, and we should be honest, we're not always at our best, but when we are at our best, connection is the whole point of church. God created church. Connection to God, connection to one another. It's this place is supposed to be this big, leafy, messy, overgrown collection of connection. We do things together that people don't do together anymore. God lives in this place, and so do we. Even the little tedious things point us to it. You know, something we do sometimes a lot in church, we wait in lines. Okay, now think about that for a moment. When you come up here for communion in a minute, you're going to wait in a line. When we have Ash Wednesday, you'll wait in a line for us to put the ashes on your forehead. And I've never really thought about that much until I started researching this sermon, and I found this quote from the actor Martin Sheen, and he was talking about going to church, and he said, "You know what I love most about going to church? I love waiting in line." Which is weird, but he's kind of a weird guy. But he said, you feel, when you're waiting in line, when you're standing in line, you feel like you're going somewhere. I don't understand it. It's a mystery. I just know when I look around, I'm with these people. Whenever I look around, I'm with these people. We sing together in church. That used to be something that people did all together all the time in lots of different places. We would sing together as people in beer halls or in fields as we worked or when we were traveling between cities. Singing together was common. Today it's rare. It's almost a novelty. Maybe if you go to a concert, you'll sing to an artist that you really love that you've gone to see in concert. But by and large, if we sing, that's rare in itself. If we sing, we tend to sing alone. Don't raise your hands to this, but how many of y'all sing in the shower? I'll raise my hand. I sing in the shower. But yes, even last Friday, I was stuck in the road of death, Paseo del Norte, in traffic, and we were just going nowhere, and I was getting impatient, and I looked over. There's this dude in the car next to me, and he's just couldn't hear anything because the windows were up, but he is singing his head off. And kind of dancing and grooving a little bit. And I just thought, you know, we ought to all be rolling our windows down and singing along to whatever he's singing to. He's having a good time. What else are we going to do? We don't sing together anymore. And previous generations would have sung together a lot. Here in church, we sing together. It's part of what we do. It's part of who we are. If I say, "Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that did what?" Can you finish the, what happened after "how sweet the sound that"? Yeah, saved a wretch like me. I didn't have to tell you the words. We never had to sit down in Sunday school and teach you what to say after that. That just was formed in you because we sing that song together. I could have picked 25 different hymns, and you probably could have more or less stumbled through the words without the words being provided to you on the screens or in a hymnal or something. Church connects us. As Methodists, we live that very particularly. We even have a word for it. It's called connectionalism. It's part of who we are. I don't know if you know this, but in the Methodist tradition, the fundamental unit of our faith is not the individual Christian who comes to Christ. It is not the local church. It is the connection. It is the big universe, not even just the Methodist church. We believe that the fundamental unit of God's family is the capital C universal church. It's important to us. You are not just a member of St. John's United Methodist Church, if you're a member. You're not just attending. You're part of a big, expansive family. We'll do that next week, by the way. We'll live it, because next week we're taking a small group to Hobbs. In Hobbs, they're starting a new United Methodist community because they lost their home church to disaffiliation. There are 15 or 20 of them who said, "No, we're not disconnecting ourselves from our United Methodist family. It's important to us. It's important to us to be connected to things like UMCOR and global disaster relief. It's important to us to be connected to brothers and sisters and siblings and others all over the world." So we're going to go to Hobbs and support them because we are connected to them. We're going to bring them some gifts. This sort of happened by accident at 8:15. And it might be a little hokey, I don't know, but we're working it in. We're going to bring them this baptismal set, this pitcher and this basin, because we want them to be doing baptism sometime soon. They're having visitors. This idea of connection is part of their DNA. And just sort of by accident, let me tell you a little bit about the history of this basin. I pulled it out of the church that closed in TRC about 3 years ago. And so I don't know how many baptisms this was used for, but probably a fair number. And then we used it a couple of times at St. John's as well, at a baptism in this service and one on Easter Sunday at 11 o'clock. This baptism we did, I will never forget. This was a little two-year-old. She was not into being baptized, never had a candidate for baptism clawing at the carpet trying to get away. Was it a baptism? Was it an exorcism? We don't know. But just sort of by accident, it's been sitting on the altar since Easter Sunday. And there's even a little bit of water that didn't get poured out that was left in the pitcher that was used in it. Now, we'll bring this baptism set to Hobbs next week. And I want you to be praying for them, even if you're not going with us. There's about 6 or 7 of us traveling. Because this set now connects us to them, to our friends, to our neighbors in that community. And I'm going to leave this water here because after the service or after you receive communion, if you want to just run your fingers through this water or touch it and just remember that there's something else that connects us with the Hobbs community and with Christians everywhere, and that is that we all share in one baptism, then do that. And be praying for the community in Hobbs as you do this. But understand this, we are connected to the same vine. People here, people worshiping around our community, across the country, and people worshiping God in communities all over the world that probably share nothing in common with us except this one connection to the one true vine in Jesus Christ. And that's a good connection. So let us pray. Gracious God, we thank you that you don't call us to solitary lives of piousness or righteousness. Not that there's anything wrong with those things, but you call us to live lives of deep connection. We're not individual Christians. We're part of the body of Christ. We're part of an amazing unit in Jesus Christ. We're part of a greater whole. and we're thankful. Amen. Our other sacrament in the United Methodist community and tradition is the sacrament of Holy Communion, something else that connects us with all Christians. And that is when we remember this meal that Jesus instituted, where he took bread, he gathered his disciples, and when he took the bread, he broke it and gave thanks and gave it to his disciples. And he said to them, "Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Then when the supper was over, Jesus took the cup and blessed it and gave thanks and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, drink, all of you. This is my blood, which is poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." Let us pray. Gracious God, in remembrance of these, your mighty acts of salvation, we give you thanks. Pour out your Holy Spirit upon these gifts of bread and wine and make them be for us the body of Christ, the body and blood of Christ, so that we may be for the world the body of Christ redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world until Christ comes in his final kingdom and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit in your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. Would those who are assisting please come forward? And as they do, let me just give you a few quick words of instructions on how to receive today. There's you have a few options. If you would like, if you're gluten intolerant and would like to receive a gluten-free wafer, or if you want the prepackaged elements, you can come to the center station and those are available for you. Otherwise, you can come to the stations on the right and on the left and receive a piece of bread and dip it into the cup and receive both elements together by intention. Finally, let me say this. Anyone who wants to follow Jesus is welcome at this table. You don't have to be a member of this church or United Methodist or a Christian or anything else. We believe that God's work and God's grace is at work in everybody. So anyone who wants to follow Jesus, Jesus has a seat for you here at his table. Give me just a moment and I will serve the servers and then we will be ready to serve you as well. Body of Christ, given for you. Shed for you. I'm going to give you the cup to serve the others. Body of Christ given for you. The body of Christ given for you. The body of Christ given for you. Table is prepared. After you have received, if you do want to touch the water, remember your baptism and say a short prayer for the community in Hobbs, do so. But most of all, just know that God has given you an invitation today and you are welcome to come.
We are one in the Spirit. We are one in the Lord. We are one in the Spirit, we are one in the Lord. And we pray that all unity may one day be restored. And they'll know we're your children by our love, yes, they'll know we're your children by our love. We will work with each other. We will work side by side. We will work with each other. Surrender to your love, and we'll know we're your children by our are one in the Lord. We are one in the Spirit. We are one in the Lord. And we pray that all unity may one day be restored.
To close today, there are a few announcements. First of all, a week from today, on April 21st, we have the King's Return Concert. They're a Grammy-nominated musical group that will be leading worship at 11 o'clock. But also on that Sunday afternoon, they'll be having a concert here at the church. Tickets are available by going to music@stjohns.org. This coming Saturday is a Mountain Cathedrals hike. If you want details, they're in the Disciple Connections, or you can talk to Mike Furnish. Omelet Bar will also return next week. And also, this afternoon, we are doing a Safe Sanctuaries course. This is for anybody who wants to volunteer or work with children, youth, or vulnerable adults. And it's really important training. Even if you're not working with those groups, it's a great training to take just to learn healthy boundaries in a church setting. And something that we take very seriously to keep those groups safe here at St. John's from abuse and other things like that. So join us for that. Especially because we have VBS coming up. And that brings me to the flyers that are on your table. That is for Vacation Bible School, which will be the last week in June. The theme is monumental, and I think that's exactly what it's going to be. So if you have little ones who want to participate, take that. Or if you have neighbors with little ones or grandkids or anything else, take one as well. With that, those are the announcements for today. So let's stand for the benediction and for singing our closing song. We go forth from this place, but we don't go alone. We go together. We go in community. So go forth in that connection. Go forth to be connected to God in your everyday life, to be connected with one another in living life together. And in that sense, go in peace and to make peace. Amen.